all seen bad television that's lasted forever, and more importantly, good television that's been canceled. And I think we all kind of have our favorites, and I wanted to talk today about our brilliant but canceled picks. But I mean, what's your go-to?
I'm going to speak for both myself and Walker. We love pushing these.
Young Ned had a special gift. He could touch dead things and bring them back to life. But he could only bring the dead back to life for 1 minute, any longer than someone else had to die. And there was one more thing he had to learn. First touch, life. Second touch, dead again, forever. But as young Ned grew into the pie maker, this gift proved to be most useful in the untimely death of his childhood sweetheart, Charlotte Charles.
Are you in love with her?
You only got a minute.
I know.
60 seconds.
I know.
What if you didn't have to be dead?
You can't touch me.
So a kiss is out of the question? You touch murder victims, you ask who killed them, you touch them again, they go back to being dead, and then you collect the reward?
That's it in a nutshell.
It only lasted a couple of seasons, and then it was gone. It had this very unique, kitschy style. They had this narrator who would pop in and explain things.
Yeah.
The cinematography was great, the costumes were cute, an exceptional use of color, which I absolutely loved.
Yeah.
And they gave it, which was sad.
It had two seasons, and the look I always kind of described as like a happier Tim Burton.
Yes, that is actually a very good description. It's very sort of Edward Scissorhands kind of look.
Yeah, it's hyper stylized, really, really in colors, and really bright.
Yeah, it really had brilliant writing. You have this very cute interaction between our hero and his childhood love where they can never touch each other. And so it's very cute where there's scenes where they hold their own hands behind their back to pretend that they're holding hands. It's just very brilliant. It was extremely funny, well written, beautiful scenery, beautiful set work. And I loved it, and I'm so sad that it.
Anyway, my show was The Black Donnellys, which was only on air for half a season. It was canceled, but the company that made it decided to put it online and finish out the first season, at least, that the viewers wouldn't be too disappointed. About a family of Irish boys who kind of accidentally took over the local mob.
Donnelly Brothers. You know them. I'm not going to lie to you. It's going to be painful.
Hey, you're Sean Donnelly, right?
Is right. Or is this some kind of vendetta?
And Tommy became everything he never wanted. And whether he realized it or not, Tommy just taken over the neighborhood.
Where are you going?
Wherever you are.
It was very much like The Sopranos, and that was kind of the problem with it because it came out and it was running at the same time as The Sopranos in the same time slot. I love the way that the writing and the camera work was done on this. It was a lot of, like, there was a lot of violence on it that was ended up being okay for daytime television or for main network television rather than, pay for cable. But they did it very, very much like Hitchcock. There'd be a lot of scenes where you'd see someone start to swing an axe or something and then the camera angle would switch, so you don't actually see the weapon, you know it's there. The writing itself, they had the narrator was masterful because it was a, they mastered the unreliable narrator. It was a guy who was being interrogated in prison. He kept lying, and then the whole scene would suddenly change because the narrator would backtrack after he was beat by the guards or whatever happened that interrupted him. And the show itself was I loved it. It was really good, and it's terrible that it's over.
It was a good show, and I was a little surprised that that one got canceled because it was right during, it was like towards the end of Sopranos run, and I had some ex-Sopranos people make it. And it was basically The Sopranos, the Irish version. And yes, it was written well. I enjoyed it when I watched it. But that one's not going to be my favorite. My favorite isn't even going to be the one that I'm wearing the shirt for. I know,
I didn't take Firefly because I thought you were going to.
No. Firefly is definitely the honorable mention. And it's the one that most geeks would probably go for.
Fireflies. But we're not just most geeks.
Firefly is the obvious gimme. Everybody wishes that they'd done that. You know, they got the movie to kind of even things out.
And it should be on the list.
It should be.
It's definitely on the list.
Well,
But my go-to one isn't that. I'm going to go for one that probably not a lot of people saw and may not be on everybody's radar, but it's one of my favorite shows, which is Studio 60 on Sunset Strip.
Jordan, are you saying that we're overreacting to this hideous, humiliating, and possibly actionable event that occurred on our air?
No. I'm saying you're dramatically underreacting to it. We don't care about any of this.
What do we care about?
They're going to say he was right.
What?
They're going to say he was right. Every cable show is going to have nonstop roundtables about how Hollywood's taking our national culture to hell on a speedboat, and we just became the symbol of that.
Now, there have become two sides to this.
When you fired Wes.
Jordan, you can't be suggesting... This is what happened in the damn movie. You can't be suggesting we give him a show back.
No, he's done at this network.
Then what are you suggesting?
Let's talk in my office. I don't know where my office is.
It was an Aaron Sorkin show. Who's the guy who made The West Wing and Sports Night. He's a very, very good writer. And West Wing was a huge show, so they gave him another show. And this one was centered on a kind of fictional Saturday Night Live, sort of the behind the scenes. The problem, however, is that there was another show that was the behind the scenes of a fictional Saturday Night Live that came out at the exact same time on the exact same network, which was 30 Rock. Studio 60 came out at the exact same time as 30 Rock, but it didn't get the love. And it tackled things that TV shows didn't really want to.
Shy away from.
Yes. So it takes place during the kind of Bush era of America, kind of after 9/11, when people considered Hollywood to be unpatriotic in general. And that's kind of what they deal with. You know, they deal with the left versus the right. And they don't particularly take a side on it. They do a good job, I think, of showing both sides and where they're coming from, and just being truthful and honest about where that comes from. You know, the people who do have faith versus people who don't, whatever.
Drug problems.
Yeah, drug problems. There's a lot of stuff that happens in that series that's just brilliant. And it's one of those that no matter how many times I watch it because I'm introducing it to someone, I still love it, I still laugh at it. It's a very dense show. There's a lot of, and I think that's brilliant. There's a lot of good jokes very quickly, and the acting is wonderful. It's the, I keep forgetting his name, but he's the only good guy from Friends.
Matthew Perry,
yes. Matthew Perry, Amanda Peet, the guy from Weeds, the brother who kind of kept on sleeping around. And this is like the only time he's really been like a good actor in something. Because usually like he's like that third tier guest star on Monk, you know, for one episode.
They have a huge cast. They have massive cast. But they all do really well. They all work really well together. You have the ability to see all of their different personalities and how they all interact with one another. And it adds to these extra layers of things that they put in there.
For the content in this episode.